Hello, my friends. Welcome to this amazing course. Hope you're doing well, amazing hacker. This course will be about OWASP Zap. So, who am I? My name is Wesley Thijs. I am a certified OSCP professional pen tester, owning my own company and having done several pen tests in the past. I like to use OWASP Zap every single time. It gives me a competitive advantage in a sense that I like to use every single scanner available, and Zap perfectly fits in there for my needs. Not only that, but Zap is context dependent, what it shows. Plus, above all of this, there's also extensibility, just like Verb Suite, but also scripting possibilities. So, if you're ready to dive in, my name is Wesley. I'm 30 years old. I'm 31 years old already. I have a daughter. I have my own pen testing company, like I said before. Before this, I used to be a QA engineer for several years, and I used to be a programmer as well. I got my networks degree as a bachelor, so I also have certificates like CCNA and ISTQB Technical Test Analyst. Let's dive into the course, shall we? So, what is Zap? Zap is a man in the middle proxy. There are more of them out there, such as Charles Proxy or Zap's biggest competitor, Burp Suite Pro. So let's get a little bit deeper into what Zap is and what it is not, and then we'll look at how we can use it in a better way. One thing I would like to point out is that Zap is being developed by volunteers completely, which is amazing if you ask me. Whereas Burp Suite, which is what it's often compared to, has a big team, because if your tool costs 400 euros per year and you sell a bunch load of them, then you'll probably have some pretty decent automated scanners. That being said, OWASP Zap's automated scanners have found things for me that Burp Suite have not. So let's get into the course, shall we, my friends? So what I'm doing right now is I'm running OWASP Zap in GUI mode, but of course I can also run it in command line interface mode, and that allows me to easily integrate into existing command CI/CD pipelines. So that way I can easily run automated scans completely for free. Why would you not do this, is what I always ask myself. So you have safe mode, as you see at the top left, protected mode, standard mode, and tech mode. These are modes in which you can put OWASP Zap, and basically attack mode means that anything that is in scope will be attacked immediately. It will be automatically scanned. You also have standard mode, and if you don't know exactly what all of these things mean anymore, that is not a huge problem. You always can open the help interface right here, and if you're looking for a specific topic like the modes, you can look for them. Let's see, you can look for attack mode, for example, and then we can see we have a attack mode in here, which we can click on, by the way, and then we can see safe mode, no potentially dangerous operations permitted, such as automated scans. Protected mode, only the ability to perform potentially dangerous actions on URLs that are in scope. Standard, we can do anything, even if URLs are not in scope. And then we have attack mode. As we can see, new nodes that are in scope are actively scanned as soon as they are discovered. So we have those possibilities. And what do we mean by dangerous operations? Spidering, active scanning, fuzzing, forced browsing, breaking, intercept, and resending requests. So if we want to intercept requests, if we want to break, that is what this green little button here is for. You can set breaks on all of the requests and responses. Now, if I put things into safe mode, as you can see right now, I have into safe mode. I will add some things later on, and then we will turn to this, and you'll see that in safe mode, I won't be able to do things like actively scan those URLs. So that is it for the Zap mode. Then on the welcome screen, you can see that you have contexts, you have your sites, and then you have your automated scans, manual exploration, learn more, and some more information about ZapCon at the moment of recording. Of course, that's going to be replaced by news, and at the bottom, you have some history, the search. As you can see, you can search through everything, then the alerts and the output. Now at the top, you can set a new project. You can open an existing project if you like. Then you can save your project. You can persist your session, as they call it, because a Zap consists, when you start it up, of a server and a database. And all of those actions are stored in a database, and you have to save that specific session. You can create snapshots of your session, and you can set some properties of your session as well. Then, of course, we have options in which we can configure things like concurrency as well. Now, we also have some UI options like dynamically switching look and feel, which will change the look of my Zap. Then I can show all tabs or only the ones that it thinks are relevant at that moment. I can also show the tab icons and not show the names to make it a little bit less cluttered if I know what I'm talking about anyway. And then you can see that I can play around with the layout of the windows a little bit as well. And this specific window, it talks about the layout of the top right window. So we also have add-on managers. We can check for updates. We can show slash enable fields. Then the breaking, as we said before, with resuming on the next step and just resuming and binning the requests and responses, in other words, throwing them away, adding custom HTTP breakpoints, which we can also choose to not intercept the full traffic, but only parts of it with the custom breakpoints. And we have the scan policy manager, which we'll get into later. Forced user mode, which is disabled since we don't have any forced users. And then we can record a zest script, look at that user guide that we were talking about, disabling the Zap HUD, which we'll get into more later as well. Open up the browser that we've configured, and we can generate reports as well, which are very useful, of course. So why would you use Zap over Burp Suite, you might be wondering. All of this is free. In Burp Suite, you don't even have the option to save your project if it's in the free version, and that's kind of terrible for me because I have to be able to save my project to work efficiently. Now, that's it for the GUI of Zap. We'll get more into some of these details that we looked at, and we'll start off with the contexts. Default context, but we can also add more contexts, starting from specific nodes if we would like that. Or we can just edit our existing one. As you can see, this has in scope and out of scope sections as well. Only thing is they're named differently. Then we can set up some structural settings, set up which technology it can and cannot intercept, set up some authentication if we have that ability, and if we have users, of course. Then we can use that authentication to create users and create forced users. Then we have some session management as well, which we can set up together with authorization. Then we have some access control rules. We have custom pages and alert filters. That's it for the context. I know that was pretty quick, but there isn't much more to this. Pretty useful little tool. It is just the scope settings. A lot of people think it's more, but if you're looking for your scope, this is where you're gonna find it. Let's have a look at that side tree at the left over here, because as you can see, when I'm automatically scanning or manually exploring my application, then I can actually fill up my side tree. And while I do that, I can right click it and I can perform an attack, for example, or I can automatically include it in context or the whole site, of course. Then I can run certain applications if they're configured. Those are Windows or desktop native applications like Windows, Linux, macOS. Flagging as contexts. We can exclude this from contexts. Of note how we cannot exclude this from the default context automatically, but we can include it. We'll have to make another context to exclude it automatically. Then we can open this URL in the system's browser, copy those URLs to the clipboard, which I can then feed into other tools later on, such as, I don't know, SQL Math for automatic testing. We can delete this node, export all the URLs to a file, export only the selected URLs to a file. We can break on there, which remember is the intercept. We can invoke certain scripts. We can add Zest script as well. Then we can expand and collapse all of the nodes. That is not something too special. We can refresh the site tree and we can save the raw request headers, as you can see our body depending on which nodes we are, and we can save as XML as well. So that's in our site tree. Now let's go over that automatic scanning, shall we? Because over here on the right we have automatic scanning, which you will be greeted by as you start up OWASP ZAP. In that automatic scanning, I can set up an URL to attack, or I can select it from my site tree as well if I like. And then I can select the option to use a traditional spider, which is going to literally spider my application. Any link that it sees, it's going to click on. I can use an Ajax spider with Firefox headless, or we can choose any browser that's installed on our system here. We can stop or start the tests, and that's about it in here. You cannot set up a lot more, but we do have a scan policy manager as well. Now, when we start from there, that option is not available, but we have that option available if we start from the attack itself. So we right click our URLs, we attack, and then we active scan. We can see that we have a policy in here. Now I cannot select it because use of the policy tab to change policy in advanced mode is not available via here. We have to use this policy tab. Now, if I want to get that back, of course, I can just disable my advanced options and I can select one of those items again. For the rest here, you really don't have to remember that much. Just remember that you can set up a context and users if you have set them up as well. And you can choose to recursively do that active scan. Now, under those advanced options, you have some filters, such as things that you don't want, certain status codes that you might not want. You have input vectors, custom vectors, where you can set your own vectors, even technologies like we saw before in the contexts and the policy, the scan policy, which is how, with a threshold, how far you want to go before alerting. And a certain strength, how deep do we want to test? And even indicate the quality of the test cases. We can set that policy per client browsing, per information gathering, injection, miscellaneous, and server security as well. Now, if I want to set up one of those scan policies, I have my scan policy manager up here in the top right. Or I can go to Analyze and then Scan Policy Manager. And then I can add more of those scan policies where I see fit, like examples for a cross-site scripting one. So that's it for my automated attacks. Afterwards, I'm going to have an attack done. Alerts will be generated. And of course, it's up to me to investigate those alerts. Feel free to do this on hexpert.com, by the way. That is my lab server, and you're throughout this course free to attack it. Hexpert.com or hexpert.com/labs if you would like to get all of them. Thank you very much. See you in the next one. Now let's talk a little bit about fuzzing, because if we right click and we attack, we can also see fuzzing pop up. So fuzzing, by the way, if you didn't notice, you have this little plus here. You can always get the fuzzer from there, and you can start a new fuzzer that way. HTTP or WebSocket. Yes, they even have WebSocket fuzzers, which is really freaking useful. Now, right now, I'm going to set up a fuzzer like this, and then I can select basically in the header text or in the body text. I can select one of these items of text, and then I can add, as you can see, a fuzz location to it. On that fuzz location, I need to add a payload as well, of course, which can be a string, it can be numbers, it can be JSON. Sometimes you might just want to count from 1 to 999 if you're just going through identifiers, and you can do it with an increment of 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. Even have a preview available and save that as well if you want to save your payload list for later uses. Afterwards, you will have a fuzz location added. You can again set up your options for concurrency when it comes to threading and your message processors as well. We can also set payload processors on here. For example, if our payload needs to be Base64 encoded first, there definitely is a possibility to do that. Thank you very much. On to the next one. Oh, I almost forgot. We have an option to follow redirects as well. For example, if I'm fuzzing http://hexpert.com, I'm not gonna find anything because on HTTP it redirects to HTTPS, which is why you always need to follow that redirect if possible. All right, on to the next chapter. Now we can also do something called directory brute forcing, and we have to right click again. This is paid in Burp Suite, by the way. We can Burp Suite Pro, that is. We can right click and we can see forced browse a site or directory, and these are basically your directory brute forcings. You can pick a word list, you can pick a specific site, and it's going to start working on it. Now, what is the difference between a site and a browse directory? As you can see, there isn't a whole lot of difference there when it comes to settings, and that is because your, there we go, site is going to browse the entire site, whereas your directory is literally going to just browse one of those directories. And of course, we have the ability to browse their children as well. It's kind of in the name, of course, but if you're not fully aware of it, now you know what those mean. Onwards into the interrupter. Now, about the interrupter, we can be very brief, of course, because we've already seen it before. We can interrupt requests, we can break on requests. So that is the interrupter that we know beforehand. We can make some changes, send the request onwards, and then we can play a little bit with it, where we can submit the step to the next request or response, and then we can submit and continue to breakpoint as well. Bind requests, and so we can add custom HTTP breakpoints in here as well. So that means when a URL matches one of these items, for example, then it will manually break as well, and it will not break on every single one of them. We've seen this before a bit already, but we can also add on add-ons as well, of course. There's quite a lot of add-ons possible, and as you can see, go through all of them. There's a few that I like, such as the X control tester. That is one that I really like. You have active scan rules as well. But for the rest, I'm not a big fan of extensions, since I think the base functionality is already plenty of for what I need at that moment. All in OneNote is also a good extension, of course, but for the rest, it really depends on your personal preferences. So I advise you to go through this, install some extensions, and see where it goes. Don't install every single extension at once, of course, because that's gonna be a huge memory hog, and you might need 32 gigabytes to run that thing. Just like we've seen automated scanning before, we can also do manual scanning. A manual scanning will enable us to get wrap our HUD. Now our HUD, it's our heads-up display. Whenever we go to a website, on the right side, we will see some information about the site, and on the left side, we will see some information about the page that we're on, some information about the vulnerabilities that have been found, and we can start tools like the spider from this HUD. Also really useful, again, we can choose Firefox or Chrome, or we can set up our own browser or system even to go through the if you go right to the options menu, we have some proxy, local proxies as well. This is where you set up your proxy settings. If you want to change anything like your port number, for example, that is definitely a possibility. So that's where you change those items. We can manually browse, and we have ZapHUD as a possibility as well. All right, so let's talk about a small pen test according to their guide. Now they recommend starting with exploration. Of course, we have to set up our scope properly, then explore a little bit. Then we can spider our target, so we can right-click attack, spider our target, and we can go and see which URLs are available. After that, we can go to force browse for come directories if we like. Now, when we have each URL, when we have a forced browsing operation going on, then we have the directories as well, giving us even more attack surface. Then it really becomes time for an automated scan. Now, the automated scan, really useful. You can set up your profiles as thoroughly as you want. Remember, in your scan profiles, in your scan policy manager right here. And then, not to forget, you can even right click and you can attack port scan your host. That is also a possibility. Then you can take that information and you can go look for exploits for that specific version. And then as last, you can also do your manual testing. Last but not least, very, very important. Be mindful of the word lists that you use while you do it, and also be mindful that these are just a few steps, very, very oversimplified of what you have to do for a pen test, but it should give you an idea and a good starting ground. Thank you very much. My name has been Wesley Thijs. This has been a pleasure teaching you, and I will see you in one of my next courses on my social media, on Twitter as the XSSRat, on YouTube as the XSSRat, or on Udemy as Wesley Thijs. You can go to hackspert.com for my labs, and you can go to the XSSRat.com for my courses. Bye, amazing hackers!